Are you on? We'll use the handheld as well, just to be safe.
Okay.
There you go.
Thank you.
Good afternoon.
So, how's your summer been?
Really, we're going there? it's been as interesting and as exciting and as tiresome and ultimately as completely physically debilitating as you might expect, because what people don't realize about having a film come out, even if it's a big, successful film, is that it's like shoveling some buddies in you. You shovel a stack of dirt 50 feet high, and you go, wow, look, we did it. And they say, yep. And go, here's a shovel. And keep going. And you just got to start again on the next one. And it's so, that's what people don't realize. It's always the same. It's never different because you're back at the typewriter again. And it's no different. You're still afraid. You're still messed up. You still don't think you can do it. You forgot everything you know. You've just written your last funny line. And no matter how good the picture was that you just did, I found that it actually gets more difficult each time rather than less. So it's a frightening summer. It's a terrifying, yeah. Also, I tend to be unhappy.
Yeah.
And I don't like things, life. You know, these are nice people. These are happy people. I mean, look at them all. Look how beautiful and young and golden they are. Well.
Story, that won't last.
Yeah, but no, we all, I was looking at my friend over there. I'm happy to be here, and I'm so thrilled that PitchFest is still going and that you guys are still here, because the secret, which you'll elicit from me, but I'm saving the trouble, I'll just tell you now, is that I wish I was you, because you're excited, you're in it, you're bright, you're young, you got it all ahead, you can't wait to taste it, you can't wait to tell the story, to make the first sale, to do all those things. You're young and beautiful and you're fresh and you're hungry. I wish I was that.
So, this might be a more challenging question, but please tell us other ways in which we're all awesome.
it's a thrill to be here. I'm really pleased. I'm blessed and I'm lucky, and I have to remember that. That as long as I'm still viable doing what I've chosen, and I think that there's no ceiling to what you can do with the talents you have. And I will share, this is what I usually say to people. You jump to the head of the line with talent because that kicks the odds out. That knocks the blocks off and just everything is different with talent. Now, here's the bad news. Most of you don't have talent. Now, and I can say that without being an asshole, because in the audience, people are, what are they going to say? They say, yeah, he's right. That guy doesn't have talent. No one's going to say, yeah, he's... So, but that's the conundrum, isn't it? You're here to find out, among the people in this room, which of you has enough determination to gut it out and see if there is actually some talent there. And you find it. It's not just you sit down and it leaps out. It's developed. It's inculcated. It's cultivated. It's teased. And, you know, extracted. So I think this is a very exciting place to be today on a Saturday. I'm always miserable, but if you're gonna be miserable about something, why not be tortured and miserable about something that has some nobility to it? Isn't writing somehow a little noble? But I feel like shit, but it's about my writing.
Yeah. You're absolutely right. So let me ask you this. You were once among the 93%.
Mm-hmm.
But you've been among the 7% for a while. Now, do you miss being among the 93, where anything you wrote would just have to be good enough for Shane Black? Like, you strive for the employment, and now when you get it, you're like, geez, I wish I didn't have to write for this Joker anymore who insists that I put an action figure in the movie.
Yeah, well, there is the business side of it, which is difficult to attend to, and a lot of these seminars are about that, too, is how to deal effectively with the business portion of it. That's a mess. But... Yeah, the good news is the first draft is yours. That's your draft. That's before they take it and say, we love it, but it's got to be, you know, it can't be an older man, it has to be a young bisexual, you know. It's before they take it and say, well, it's great, but, you know, it can't be R, it has to be PG. That first draft is the way you intended. When you write fade out, that was always the favorite thing for me, was to just type fade out and sort of blink and understand feebly, and not quite getting it yet, that I got through another thing. And it took a while to register, because it was so impossible at every step of the way. The writing seemed so precarious and so difficult that I never thought I would ever finish something. And when it was done, it was always a minor miracle. How many people here, I'll ask a question. How many people here find writing to be exciting, fun, and easy, and you can't wait to get to the table? I had a friend who was like, hi, I'm writing today. What, oh, this, I'm doing great. I got a wife, two kids. I did, take them to school. I go to PTA at night between 12 and 2 in the morning. I just write, and I love it. Are you kidding me? You have a full day, you exhaust yourself, and then you approach the typewriter with anything other than just sheer fucking dread? He says, yeah, it relaxes me. I mean, the one thing writing doesn't do is relax me. I mean, it either terrifies me, or there's that zone you get when you catch on to something, when you actually latch on and for a moment you go, oh, wait a minute, this could be good. Holy shit, this could be good. And then there's that feverish sort of like, I don't want to answer the phone and I don't want to take time off for food. And that's its own animal, but that's not calm, you know? And I envy the calm people. Ask me a question.
I shall. Your writing process, as you've mentioned, is one of torture and an endurance race, let's say. But when you read your script, when you read Lethal Weapon, so on the let's call it the Blackian style, it seems very conversational and sort of lighthearted, almost like an interaction between you and the reader. So do you somehow manage to take your torture and even further drive it inside to torture yourself even more in order to interact with someone else through the words on the page?
I think what you'll find is it's very hard to write a comedy, and people who write comedies are usually pulling their hair out. I had an office next to Larry David. He'd pace up and down the hallways, and I'd see him, and he didn't look happy.
Yeah. You know?
But the idea that, yeah, to be funny is hard, and so it makes you unhappy to try to write something that's that difficult, and you said, no, that line isn't funny enough. You try it again, you try it again. And there's nothing like the exhilaration, even momentarily, that comes from, not only is that line funny, but I can pay it off here, and it's a callback to this, and I can bring this around, and this character, you know, those things. So, I guess what I'm stressing in this early sort of informal Q&A I want to convey to you how nuts I was as a kid, how awful the writing process was for me, how arbitrary and seemingly haphazard the success I've had arrived at my door. And I'll tell you what it came down to. And this is a story that is at once inspiring and also terrifying. I was writing a script. I sat down to write something. The very first script, I'd never written anything. And it was called Shadow Company. And I wrote the first scene. I came home, I took time off from school. Wrote the scene, it was 10 pages, I gave it to my brother, and he didn't like it. And he said, it's just, I don't know, man, it's kind of violent, it's kind of weird, it's a little rough, and it's distasteful to me. I don't think this is a movie I'd want to see. And I idolized my brother. So I sat down at the typewriter and they say, and I was almost in tears. I was like, I can't do it. I failed. It's done. And I sat at my little green manual typewriter. And I remember giving up, and there's a page in front of me and it's blank, and I didn't want to continue, and I had given up, And I thought, oh. And I just said, I don't know, start typing. And I hit a key. And I typed, the door opens. Oh, I hate this. I fucking hate this. And I'm right. Every word was hateful. And then a character came in and said something, and I thought, blah, blah, blah. And I just kept writing, I'll finish it. I might as well finish it. I'm halfway through the page now. And then it was, wait a minute. That's, I don't know, that's kind of a good line there. What if I, and pretty soon I'd finished a page, and pretty soon I'd thrown out the scene I gave my brother. I had a new scene that was 4 pages long, and it was a totally different scene. But I remember the moment where my finger was poised over the typewriter, and there was a decision. I was ready to stop writing and just go do something else. And I actually decided, even though I want anything else in the world but to type right now, I let that finger descend and hit that key. And that one moment was an entire career. Without that one moment, script didn't get finished, didn't show it to my friend, didn't give it to his agent, didn't, you know, option that, sell another, get Lethal Weapon, move on. It was a moment where I was ready to give up and I hit a key, loathsome as it was. And that made all the difference. So that's pretty, it's interesting to me, looking back, to note that it was that sort of precarious between you'll do this and that'll be your future, or you're gonna sell shoes.
A lot of the instruction that a lot of us get when we're just starting out and writing, trying to figure out what to do, you get, you know, show, don't tell, you get, only mention what you can see and hear on the screen.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of times that gets interpreted as he wore a blue shirt and he's 6 feet tall.
Right.
But what you come up with is this is the kind of house you want to have sex in.
Well, that's the line. But that's not very funny, by the way.
Well, it's
the one that always gets quoted. Like, I have a house and I describe it. This would be a really great place to have sex.
But that evokes an image without specific physical description.
Well, yeah, but so would, you know, this would be a great place to eat a tiger alive. I mean, but I
wouldn't. That would be a different house.
Yeah. And you're right. You're right.
So,
I'm sorry, can I stand up?
Please.
I'm going to stand up just because I don't like sitting. And I'll just. Doesn't imply anything. I'm not sort of lording it over.
Please. Just, lord all you want, number one movie in the country.
Yeah.
But
world, thank you.
So, can you talk a little bit about people not only trying to break into the industry, but like trying to develop their craft about evocative language and how, and word choice, it that not only makes it for a good read, but also is inspirational to a director, which you are also doing. You know.
Yes. Yeah, well, here's what you don't do. Which a friend of mine gave me a script recently, and I started reading it. It says, Jody enters the room and crosses to the bed. She is in town on a tour with the NC something or other that she represents, and she's recently talked to Todd, who told her to go to this hotel. You know, it's like, and I had to call her and say, no, that's a book. That's a story. But the other thing you don't do is, you know, the police enter, shots are fired. Stunt follows stunt as the hero attempts to, you know, that's the other thing you can't do. You have to describe what happens. You have to tell people what they're gonna see on screen, but you gotta make it read like it's gonna feel when you watch it. So what to me is exciting is not to specifically describe everything you see, blue shirt, tan shoes. What to me is exciting is to convey with the flow of the words the breathlessness, the pauses, the beats of it, to show the director how the scene's gonna play, how it's supposed to feel in its unfolding. Where there's a breath, where there's an intake where you go, oh my God, where there's a stunning moment, where there's a breath, you know, where two people look at each other. I mean, I'll have two people look at each other for half a page, and it's kind of silly because it's only 10 seconds of film. But you may want to convey what happens in that moment when they're staring at each other, what's going on in their heads, only because it's going to inform the way that that's played. There was this movie that was made where a guy is a real dick to his wife. And he like tosses her aside, says, "The hell with you," and he goes storming out of the house. And they showed it, and the audience came back with their feedback, and they said, he's just a jerk. We don't like this character. But they didn't want to change it, so they added a scene. They shot this little bit. He says, the hell with you. He throws his wife aside, and he's heading for the door, and he stops, and they added him. He looks in for a moment at his son, who's asleep in bed, and just stares at him for a minute. And then he goes out the door. And now the scene was fine. Because you told people it's okay to like him because he has a sleeping son. And in the same way, you know, you can say in the screenplay, in this moment, we understand that this movie is about racism. In this moment, with the looking, we understand that all the events we saw in the last, the elements come together in this moment and amount to one statement, blank. And it's not on the screen, but the director knows that this is the moment we're supposed to connect those things and feel that, and so he'll know to add that. And the reader gets it too. You can tell people what they're to expect to feel. Other times, I love just telling you what happens and not telling you what to feel, just counting on the ability of those words and their placement to evoke the feeling. So blah, blah, blah. I'm bad at it. It's not very good. But sometimes I'm really good at it. That's the thing. Sometimes I suck. This is what's weird about writing, which is just so frightening to me. I'll get up and write a scene on a rusty day, and I'm the worst. I'm the worst writer in the world on those days. I throw it in the drawer. I come back the next day, write something I like. It's just catch as catch can. Now, here's the weird news. 6 months down the line, I'll take that scene out of the drawer, and all of a sudden it looks good to me. It's not that bad. And the one that I thought I was so proud of may look like shit to me at that point. So I don't know what this is. Are these interacting?
That might be the case.
Yeah, let me. If this is working, I'm going to strip off this thing. Hang on, don't get excited.
It's going to get sorely very good. All right. All right.
Catch.
Quite the out the window.
Thank you.
This very charming, sweet, pretty girl. Give her a hand.
Yeah.
How many people in this room have a metal thing in their nose? Okay. I always used to see in college, there was always a guy who was a tough guy, or thought he was, who had a thing that came out of his ear like a chain, and it came up and was in his nose. And I thought to myself, how smart is that, really? You know, if you're a tough guy, it's like, oh. We have like a lot of tough guys, and none of them have that particular kind of movie. No, they don't. You have a fine head of hair, by the way. Oh, thank you. You have to shatter yourself. Propitia. So this question is impotent, but I have right here. This question is for me. Was it awesome being a predator? Was it awesome being a predator? It was good being a predator because it was ostensibly a job that came across as a writing position. Being handed this opportunity to travel to Mexico, but I knew I didn't want to write on the movie. So they said, well, we'll put you in it, and then you can travel down and be with us and learn all about these things, and then you'll write some lines for us, right? I said, yeah, well, sounds good. And then when we got there, they said, write some lines. I said, I don't want to. I'm dry. So it was just a chance for me to, I mean, I know things in that movie that are, I think, very hilarious, like, the dysentery stories of, there's the one sunny land, Shane, this is sunny land, big Indian guy. And there's a scene with his major, there's something in those trees, and it ain't no man. And I knew that he was clenching because the second he uncut, he was shitting himself. So you see this bold sort of, there's something in those trees, Jesus. So when you're directing now, do you say, act as if you have dysentery? Were you trying to get a certain reaction out of an actor? It's interesting getting reactions out of actors, you know. You can't hit them. You need
But there's a, I don't know. I find that it's just about getting people who, people want to be an open book. They want to trust someone so that they, someone can lead them. I don't know a lot of actors that want to make every choice and do everything themselves. They want to open themselves up and say, okay, in essence, hey, you know, tell me something, make me cry, make me do this, make me do that. And it's fun to do that. Often one of the easiest things, if someone has an emotional scene, it's almost sadly simple to just say, okay, great, do it again. What? And do it again, and then do it again. And right when they can't do it anymore, say, I need you to do it one more time. Like, can't do it one more time. Do it one more time. And the one more time is the one you use. Because they're just, by that time, it's just a repetition. You've broken them down.
Isn't that how they got the performance out of Shatner and Wrath of Khan? So many times he couldn't be a Ham anymore.
It may be. I think he is pretty good at Wrath of Khan. Speaking of that, you guys have seen summer movies. What did you think of the Star Trek movie?
I thought they were both very good, but it actually leads me to a question I was going to ask about. I'll ask you later. The difference between writing a story that you own versus jumping onto a fan base that is passionate and large, like you did about Iron Man.
Well. You closet yourself is the thing. You don't go out and take a poll of the fans. You just go with the people who are making the movie, and you sit in a room and in a very insular kind of chummy way, come up with what do we want to do next for this character. So Marvel is a little more difficult. They're very possessory. They have a very proprietary attitude about their characters over there, so you can't just say, I think Thor should be gay, you know?
Should be.
But it's
working with this proprietary characters must tie your hands, but at the same time you're like part of a
challenge.
But you're part of this gigantic phenomenon now that you sort of have a responsibility to. Briefly, I was reading the article in Forbes about the screening of Iron Man 3 that was here that you talked to the fans afterwards. We'll talk about that a little bit.
Right. Well, you have a mythology with these pictures. Someone once said, I think it was the Grant Morrison, the comic book writer, said that comic books are unique, comic book characters, because they represent the longest, continuous, uninterrupted modern mythology. It's not Dickens, not, you know, the classics, nothing like comic books conveys an unbroken chain of myth through our current age. In 1939, you could go buy a Batman comic, and from then until now, you can go to the store at any time during the Vietnam War, during the Korean War, during trade embargoes, you can go to the store and you can find out what Batman's doing. And the mantle's passed from writer to writer, artist to artist, but it's an unbroken, continuous myth. So I think that's fascinating. I think the fact that there's this system of, like, you take the baton, pal, you know, and he takes it and runs with it for a couple years, and Spider-Man evolves and eventually, I guess, dies recently, which is kind of retarded, but
they all die.
The point being that this is really, you can always find out what they're doing. They're always there and they always have been in my life. As long as I can remember, I can find out what Spider-Man's doing at any time. I just go to the store. So I love that notion with Iron Man, that we were part of the mantle having been passed. I thought to myself when we were sitting down to write, what do you do with Iron Man? Well, the fans wanted this villain to Mandarin, isn't it? And the Mandarin was a concoction in the 1960s, early 60s, 61 and 2, that was based upon the fact that at that point in time, the thing that you could not picture a more terrifying thing as an American than a Chinese communist. That was the villain, the boogeyman, back in 1962. So, in this day and age, how do you represent the Mandarin? Well, obviously the boogeyman now is... So the modern boogeyman being this sort of world of international terror. And then I thought, you know, we were thinking to ourselves, well, you know, we have this AIM think tank, and if there's a think tank, wouldn't it occur in this culture of fear to a modern-day terrorist, to a modern villain, to avail himself of a cobbled-together terrorist, preying on the fact that it's a media-driven culture, so to create a media-savvy terrorist that is actually a think tank concoction. People come to work in the morning and they say, what scares America? And they come up with this guy. And the guy behind the scenes would be the real Mandarin, who is unbearably corrupt inside. And he has a dragon on his chest that's just beating to get out to show him that he's the real villain, but he covers it up and instead projects everything into this sort of, you know, straw man that he's created, this golem, yeah. I thought that was cool, especially when you consider that the idea of a Mandarin, the definition of a Mandarin is not the king, it's the kingmaker. It's the anonymous guy behind the throne who whispers in the king's ear, the advisor, that's the Mandarin. And so I thought, well, that sounds perfect. The Mandarin is an advisor who's created the ultimate terrorist with the think tank, AIM. Okay, so we had fun with that. Cut to 2 weeks after the movie came out. You douche! You ruined the Mandarin! You should die, you should never live! I can kill you! Okay?
I wish you were exaggerating. It's just...
You should never make a movie again. Keep him away from Bond. So, geez, it's like these are they're family members or something. It's like I raped their dog. So I said, okay, look. The dog's fine. I was just trying for something a little bit snazzy because we weren't supposed to do the Avengers, right? We weren't supposed to. We didn't want to. That was aliens flying around in ships like little sky chariots and blowing stuff up. And we wanted to do Cold War espionage. And that was, it seems to me that even from the beginning, Iron Man 1 had its basis in something a little more grounded, a little more realistic than the other Marvel superheroes. His genesis was in Vietnam. In the comic books, which even as a kid I recognized as something you could watch on the news at night. So, the idea of the Mandarin giving way to the guy behind the Mandarin, who is this truly evil guy who scripts him and wants desperately to finally stand up and say, no, it was me all along. I like that very much. I still think it's a cool story idea. It's not a political message, there's no political point to Iron Man 3, except that it's a cool story.
But the fans didn't quite see it that way.
Yeah, well, the fans
didn't. The Mandarin fans.
All they wanted was what they knew from comic books. Now, the other thing Kevin Feige and I talked about endlessly, by the way, Marvel liked the idea too. It was like, how could you do this to Marvel? It's like, dude, I don't go in there and tell Marvel what to do. It's like, I'm gonna do the Mandarin this way. Shane, don't, we don't want that. Fuck you, Marvel. He's not gonna be real.
Oh, geez, ruining it. What can we do?
No, they're all into it. They love it. So it's just, they don't get it. You know, it's like, they think directing is like, you know, and he put the wrong shoe on him in this scene. I didn't put any shoes on. I didn't do anything. So
there was the screening, and there were fans who had a problem with it, and you sat and you talked to them.
But they didn't have a fan problem with it, I don't think. I just came out and said, anybody have a problem with it? And one guy stood up and said, hey, well, I kind of didn't like that he wasn't real.
But then you said, let's talk.
Well, I just said, I'll skip to the chase. The article you're referring to is kind of false.
Oh.
Because I did talk to them after, but no one said, I didn't stick around because there were angry fans. And I just went up in front because I happened to be there anyway and said, yeah, what did you think of the movie? And a couple people came back and said, yeah, it was pretty good, but we didn't like this one thing. I said, the hell with you. And I stormed out. It was a disaster. People know. Mothers grabbing their children.
That's actually a better story than Forrest. But you do have accessibility to your fans. I mean, you've done this event 3 or 4 times. We've seen you seen out of the
Because gym. The fans are me, and I am the fans, and they're fans of the movie, they're not fans of me. I just make the story that they like. But if you like me, if you're here to see me because I'm a cool guy, you got the wrong room.
It doesn't say Iron Man up here. I mean, they're here to see something else.
They're here to see what they perceive. I'm guessing, because I'm not asking you. I'm telling you what you're feeling, which is kind of nasty. And how dare you think that? I think that they're here to see what they think they want to be, what place they want to be. And I'm giving them a mixed message, because I'm saying it's a lot of fun, and we have fun, we do great stuff. And I'm also saying it's torturous, and it's not the end game that you want, and it's not the fun that you perceive, and it's never the goal that you think you're getting, and it's always the next stepping stone. Because every time you say to yourself, I'm gonna get this one thing and my life will work, I have found in my experience that that is wrong. If you think, if I just sell a screenplay, my life will work. I'll be able to say, Mom and Dad, take a look at this, and you know, to hell with my former employer, and I'm in Hollywood now. Yeah, when do you get to your first story meeting? And they rape you. And you're gonna say, oh my God, if I could just get a movie made that I even like, because these bastards are trashing me. If I could just get a movie made that's good, my life will work. And then you get a movie made that works. Guess what? It goes on forever. You're never gonna find that piece that you want. You're never gonna find the place where you're standing here saying, I am so fucking bitching. And I'm so happy to be here. I'm an alcoholic, so I have this tendency, as alcoholics do, to place myself, you know, above, like I know what I'm doing and you don't know anything, or to be completely below and say I'm a piece of shit and I'll never be as good as you guys. And that, but never to meet you on an even keel, never to meet you here. I think that's kind of indicative, not just of alcoholics, but of writers as a general rule, that they go from grandiosity to despair with this incredible seeming alacrity. You know, it can happen in a split second. The way I describe my life to people is I'm walking down a street in a lovely neighborhood. There's great looking houses with green lawns on this side, a blue sky with clouds in front of me. On this side is a 1,000-foot drop to despair and rocky death. But there's a tissue-thin membrane, tissue-thin, that's painted to look like the rest of the neighborhood. So if I walk straight, I can uncross my eyes and blur them a little bit. I can just say, I'm walking in the nicest neighborhood ever, things are great. That tissue-thin membrane will always be there. And anything can throw it off, and I just go, I don't just go, oh, I feel a little bad today. You know, kill me now. These kinds of mood swings, while entertaining from the outside, are indicative of a kind of writing process that you probably don't want to have. So you probably don't want to learn anything from me, except maybe structure or story points or things like that. But if you want to learn about what it takes to be happy as a writer, ask him.
That is terrible advice. It's funny you mention that, because at some of your previous appearances here, you've talked about being part of a community of writers and reaching up for help and reaching down to help others. So the isolation part of writing made me feel despair, but being part of a community of writers, you want to talk about giving back and having been given to in the first place and so on?
Yeah, I mean, how many of you have sold a script?
Okay.
How many of you paid for this conference?
We need a lot more like you, by the way.
So there's basically like three people here who actually have money to spend on this, and the other... No, this is good. This pitch fest is good. Don't get me wrong. You want to sell your script. How do you do that? Everyone, that's the question. I want to get an agent. People come up to me. How do I get an agent? How do I sell a script? How do I get someone to read my work? All these questions. Answers, the obvious answers are, I don't know, go away, I'm not going to read it. More difficult answer is, realistically, how? Yeah, because it's tough. There's a lot of unemployment, and no one here has sold it, so how are you going to get an agent? How are you going to sell that script? Well, all I have to offer is what's based on my personal experience, which is that if I'd been alone, I probably couldn't have gotten anywhere, but I surrounded myself with a group of like-thinking people, and we were buddies first. I think that's the key. In college, I had these pals, three girls, maybe seven, eight guys, that we used to hang out and just talk endlessly about movies. We were real nerds, real film buffs. And that's the key. None of us was in the business yet. We were just friends. That's how it started. It wasn't about using each other. It was about clinging together in a lifeboat. Then, as we started to get successful, each of us, in turn, were able to extend a hand down the ladder and sort of help someone up a rung, and that person would then leapfrog up the ladder and reach down and help someone under them. And I was given the chance by Fred Decker, my friend, who introduced me to an agent and got my script read. Subsequently, I was able to give a hand to someone else. We helped each other. We liked each other. That's important. We were on the same beam. We sort of saw the same movies. We argued. But we were always out at 3 in the morning making some little movie on our stupid little, you know, overlarge 1980s video system. And the importance of surrounding yourself with people, I don't think you can really underestimate that or understress it. In the good times, it's great. In the bad times, it's great. If you're drowning, if you're sinking in a boat, would you rather be alone or have someone? And then you look over and it's like, they're saying, this is terrible. We're drowning. It's like, I know, it feels awful. I totally agree with you. You've got someone to commiserate with in the drowning, sinking boat. Or you've got someone to celebrate with after you, through mutual, just sort of endless nights, pain, misery, striving, you come up with something together or in tandem or just by some. And that's the other thing. We used to shift pages to each other back and forth. What do you think of this? It's okay. What about this? And we would constantly critique, edit, support, embellish each other's work. I'm going to borrow the bit with the cigarette, Fred, from my script. Can I take it? Yeah, just take it. I don't need it. None of this, like, I don't want to get you to read my work. What if you, I'm going to sue you. There was none of that. This distrust. This guy called me from the Midwest. I used to be in the phone book. Oh, Mr. Black. My name's Kevin. And, hell, you know, I got a hell of a story. I think it makes a great movie. All right, well, I'm not really supposed to listen to stories. I'm just telling them, no, because I'm going to say, if you won't go in on this story with me, I mean, this is going to make a great movie, and I would go half-half with you. Like, all right, well, what is it? He goes, well, I won't tell you. How do I know you're not just going to take it? Dude, you fucking called me. I'm not soliciting you. It's not like I'm sitting here like I'm so dry, I wish fucking Kevin would call me. But it's this level of presumption and entitlement and, like, you know, my stories are so good that I'm going to waltz into Hollywood. And they come to Hollywood, and then you ask some of these writers, some of the people who may have been in this room, what have you got? They go, well, I'm here to be a writer, but I've got a couple great ideas, and half a treatment, but I've got some cool ideas I want to pitch. And dude, you came to Hollywood. Where's your scripts? You have three of them. Have three under your arm when you get here. Your best work. Be ready. You don't come out, it's like the magic actress who comes out here and says, well, I slept with rich guys and now I'm going to hang out in the Schwab's pharmacy. No, that doesn't work. Well, the rich guys works, actually, but, and girls who doubt this come up to me afterwards. So, it's this entitled attitude. You got to surround yourself with people that were friends first. No bullshit. No, I'm going to sue you. Share. Support. Help. Fondle. Cradle. Fondle the pages. But do that to each other. And I think you'll find that if you want to start a writer's group, start a writer's group. Uh-oh, fuck. He's using too many swear words. Get him off the stage.
Not for you, it's him.
Oh. Am I spotting? There's a... You know you can join a writer's group. There's plenty of fiction groups. People who will read to each other, share each other's words, go online together, and you can start a group if you don't know of one. Say, hey, I know some friends who are into this with me in my screenwriting class. Let's all get together on Thursday nights and read scenes to each other. Do it. Do that. Get that feedback. Have that fun. It's the only fun you'll have as a writer or your friends. Because the lazy, awful, day-to-day, facing that computer, it might be entertaining and fulfilling at some point. Get those kids out of here. No, I'm kidding. All right. Now, totally blew your flow. That's all right. Now, I do. One time. Fortunately, that was interesting. So we're done with that. We're going to move on. I love it because the kids have no reaction. They look like. So stick with your friends. Yeah, no, that's okay. Stick with your friends and basically do something that feels like it's a bonded, commingled kind of experience. That I love the fact that the group that I came up with, we called the Patter Guys at that time, back in the 80s, included Chris Matheson, who did Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure and a bunch of other films. Most recently, he's got Rapture Palooza coming out. Ed Solomon, who did Men in Black and a bunch of other things. Fred Decker, who did The Monster Squad with me. Jim Hertzfeld, who did Meet the Parents. David Silverman, who did The Simpsons. You know, it goes on and on. Actors, writers, all from that same group at UCLA that I just stumbled upon as sort of lost souls seeking comfort away from home for the first time in college. And it turned into something that was a real banner year. That class that I graduated with went on to do some pretty amazing things. And I think it was because of the support that we had for each other.
So I don't know how much you're allowed, we finish at 4, is that right? So around 3:30 I'm going to start taking questions from the audience. There's plenty of time. We're going to just a little housekeeping. There's a microphone here in the middle aisle. We're going to just line up at that rather than trying to call on people. So. That'll be soon in about 10 minutes or so, but until then, I don't know how much you're able to talk about it, but what's up next?
No reason not to talk about it.
Well, I don't know.
But let's see. I don't know.
What do you got?
We might steal
Panda Express or something.
No, I mean, give me a script. I'm doing this. There's a character I always dug from childhood that was a real special thing growing up for me. Not even so much for a lot of the actual stories, but just the book covers, which I pored over endlessly. And this was the Doc Savage series that was initially in the 1930s as a pulp magazine series, and then reprised again in the 60s as paperbacks. I love Doc Savage. It came before Superman, and Superman was based on Doc Savage. He has a Fortress of Solitude, Doc Savage. He even calls it that. He says, physical marvel, mental and mental wizard, I guess. But more than that, we had to find the humanity in this character and make it interesting and find a hook that he's not Superman. And so going back to my pulp roots seemed really fun for me. There's also this lovely series of books called The Destroyer. Anyone know it? Jesus, we're fucked. The Destroyer was initially a series in the 70s when they had all these men's adventures, these books with hair on them, you know, the Executioner, the Butcher, the Ripper, the Snorter, the Exterior, you know, all these characters. And the best of the bunch was this sort of weird satiric, kind of politically savvy, very brutal but funny action series called The Destroyer. Now, they made a movie previously about The Destroyer called Remo Williams, The Adventure Begins.
that movie made me want to cut my wrists. It got everything wrong. So I'm trying to get everything right. I'm hoping that we can do the Destroyer. Boy, these projects don't excite people. Okay, I'm doing
I think that the other thing we have is Death Note, which might go at some point.
Three Asian people.
maybe I could just be one of those rock groups that's big in Japan. Other than that, man, it's digging the dirt. We have this thing with Cameron Diaz we're trying to make, which I'm producing, called Agent Century 21, about a frumpy mom who sells real estate and ends up taking down the Mexican drug cartels.
And that's a good pitch right there, by the way.
Yeah.
Where's Cameron Diaz help?
Here's what doesn't help. They Bob Cosberg. You know Bob?
Yeah.
I like Bob. He's a good guy, but the idea that all you have to do is come up with log lines. I just want to throw them out the window. So we go up with a log line about that.
Before we turn to the questions, let's talk just a little bit about Kiss Kiss Bang Bang. Why did you decide now you want to be a director? We got you covered. Decide why you want to now become a director, and directing someone else's writing probably was not part of the equation when you made that.
No, I wanted to be a director because writing was drudgery and boring and ultimately very satisfying until it got to a director who would then do things which I occasionally but not often agree with, you know. So I thought, it's a weird feeling to watch a film done by someone who's had hit movies and say, yeah, I guess, but I think I would have done that a little differently. Yeah. That doesn't really capture the beat or the moment. It kind of races through it, or there's a breath there they could have taken and didn't, or that action scene was overplayed or too lavish. I didn't like the location. So I thought, these are things you have to solve at some point. You have to take the reins, because why not? Because there's no ceiling. Because you can do what you want. I've had so many off and on relationships, girls guys do, not the relationship, but the people who say the universe a lot. They use the word the universe a lot. And I tend to run from those people. Because I appreciate what they're saying, this law of attraction and stuff. It's like, I'm going to so much people, I'm going to buy the car now. And I'm going to go and sit in the office of the producer and just say, I am here selling my script. And all these affirmations and wish walls and things like that. Okay, I still believe that you can do anything you want with footwork. It's positivity and footwork. And of course, being prepared, because as we all know, good luck is where, opportunity meets preparedness. So if someone knocks on your door and says, hey, you got a hammer? And you don't have a hammer, that doesn't work. But if you've got what they need, they'll come in. Because no one's going to come to your door and just say, excuse me, hi, I was in the neighborhood. I'm wondering if anyone in this room has some screenplays. Drive it by and notice your house could use a lick of paint, but I thought maybe there's writers in there. It's not going to happen.
But even at work, if it were to happen, if you don't have those three scripts ready.
Right. Prepared. So for me, I had to say to myself, I can get anything I want. I'm going to ask for it. And I asked for it, and I got told no so many times in such quick succession that I got beaten down like a fucking puddle of shit. And I just stood up and I said, because this was funny too, and this will show you. I used to have scripts come out, and my scripts actually used to sell a lot back in the 80s. And they would sell in such a way that was really remarkable. But I would come up with a script, and my agent would say, okay, Mr. Black has a new script. We're not going to send it to you, but you can come to the office and read it. But we'll give you half an hour. And you got to leave now. And then people go,
oh shit, they would actually come to the office to read the script to see if they wanted to buy it.
That's kind of cool, actually.
Yeah. Cut to 2002. Kiss, kiss, bang, bang. I give it to someone. Here it is, my new script. And week goes by. Nothing happens. Call, go in the office. I go meet with the guy. I meet with the guy who works for the guy, who says, well, it's a little misogynist for my taste. Oh, and this happened, and some independent financier says, well, we'll do it, but if you cut this and cut that and add this and add this, and we really want to make a message about, you know, social injustice in Bahrain. So there's a way you can put that in. All of a sudden, the magic had gone. The golden boy, whatever syndrome that was briefly, was evaporated. So one guy said, Joel Silver. He looked at the script, he said, yeah, it's 10 pages too long, but I like it, cut it, we'll make it. Now, still there were problems because Joel said, well, I'll only make it if Mel Gibson plays the gay guy.
I don't think Mel Gibson would have a problem with that.
I said, he's not going to play the gay guy. He said, I can talk him into it. Joel, he's always, yeah, like that. And so, of course, after a year of waiting, Mel came back and said, basically, are you crazy? You know, the anus is for one thing only. That's a paraphrase of what I think he actually said on the radio.
So he left word on a wire well behind him.
And I thought, well, all right, so Joe, but we got, and up until the last second, we had Robert Downey, who couldn't be insured, but happened to be, thankfully, dating Joel's assistant, or co-producer, and we had Val Kilmer come in, and Joel said, oh my God, are you kidding me, these two? And he canceled the movie, like a week before we're to shoot it. He said, I can't do it, this is not gonna be a... And then we talked to him, and he said, you know what, I'll take a shot at it. And so for that, and forevermore, I shall respect him, and also the fact that in the editing room, Joel was an absolute genius. I've never seen anybody take apart, dissect, memorize, and spit back every shot of a film with seeming eidetic, photographic memory, the way that Joel did. But it was wild. And then I had a movie, and now I'm directing the two biggest assholes ever. Or so it was said. I was terrified. Everyone said Robert was an asshole. Everyone said Val was an asshole. And they would look at me knowingly. They would like wink at me and say, yeah, well, wait till you find out what you just bought yourself, pal. And of course, they were princes, so they were great. And I love them both very dearly on a given day.
And in retrospect as well, you still love them both?
Oh, yeah. I worked with Val again in a heartbeat. And Robert, of course, I just worked with, so. I like the idea of working with the same people over and over again. Chris Nolan, you know, fills his movies with the same people over and over again.
First of all, I loved Iron Man 3. I thought the character development was awesome. Congratulations. They don't deal with the deck. You enjoy it and surprised you as an actor and writer. Sometimes we go to movies and, oh, I know what's going to happen, and I didn't, so thank you for that. Second of all, as a director now, out of the writer box, congratulations. As George Clooney would say, out of the box. Are you more Clint Eastwood style, where you just kind of let them do their thing, you put little works, or you take many, many takes and you just try to get as much as you can?
Well, it's different. I don't think there's any one answer for that, because actors heat up differently. For instance, I made a mistake on Kiss Kiss Bang Bang on the first day. Robert heats up quickly, so he'll do three takes, which is really intense, and then he's like, I'm done, I just blew it out. Val fumbles through his first three takes, and then catches fire and gets it. So, of course, I shot over Robert onto Val first. So now Val's fumbling and Robert's burning himself out. And we're on Val. So the trick is to find out who heats up fastest and shoot them first. And, you know, and as far as, I love what Clint does, where notoriously Clint never yells action. He just gets everyone very quiet. And he just says, okay, go ahead.
One other question. I have a script right now that we're in pre-production. So would you, if you're doing it today, would you just film it, spend 20, 30 grand, whatever you have to do to get it done, it's cheaper now, with cameras and everything, and just put it into some of these festivals and see if you can get some traction that way as an actor and a writer and a producer?
What would the alternative be?
Well, I mean, you know, pitching it, the script. I mean, is it just better to do it and get it done? Like you said, you were out there doing it.
Of course, there's always another idea. This is not a baby that you need to score with on your first big hit. Hollywood has to be the biggest hit you've ever had. This might be, it might be a blessing to do something small, cut your teeth on it, learn a few things, and get some festival exposure. It leads to the bigger project. Unless you feel that this is the uncut gem waiting to be discovered that is going to propel you into the studio world, I would say there's no reason not to make it happen. Any kind of independent financing you can find.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Can a chick ask a question, or is this just guys? All right.
I had a question in terms of writing. I wondered if, in your opinion, if you ever thought of revisiting a character in a separate genre, like a Martin Riggs, for example, where it wouldn't be action, it wouldn't be killing people, but he'd be dealing with personal issues?
I don't think anyone's ever done it, mostly because it seems like a risk, because the whole point of making these movies is to carve a niche that people are comfortable with demographically.
Yeah.
The closest I can think of anything that ever did that was, remember Lou Grant on the Mary Tyler Moore Show?
Yeah, that's a good example.
It was a comedy, and then later he came back and they did a drama where he's still Lou Grant, but now it's a big city drama.
Yeah.
And people seem to go for it. I think Martin Riggs is most known for his proficiency with the lethal art of, taking people and making them into burger would probably not be the best choice for,
do you think it's
Father possible? In Winter's Bone. What?
Do you think it's possible that in a separate genre, a character like Martin Riggs could, it would be interesting to see him struggling as maybe a father or with more human issues, because you've already seen him in multiple films.
Yeah, you've written the script, haven't you? Yeah. No, I actually think it would be fun. Exactly. It would be fun, but I would recommend you don't have to take it out of the genre, because here's the only flaw in the ointment there that I see. Why make the distinction between having it be in a movie that's a thriller where he does it and having it be in a drama where it's about that? Why not just say, if you want more elements that are human, if you want to bring in more drama, just edge it in that direction. Look what Bond went through from, if you look at You Only Live Twice and Skyfall, those are two different worlds in the same character. So you can edge things in a direction with those same characters that emphasize different parts of their lives and that sort of skew the movies in terms of a tone and feel that's more appropriate to what you want.
You were talking earlier about the ongoing mythology in comic books. I mean, you talked about different genres. I mean, you see that a lot in the genre you're now. I mean, the difference between Adam West and Frank Miller.
It's true. I have a hunch that, the problem with what you're describing too is that first you would have to have a hit movie that exists here and then take the character, so it's a kind of a 1-2 punch that's even more difficult. But if you already have a script or you already made a movie, why not make a sequel that's a little bit tonally different? I think that's actually a very interesting idea.
Alien and Aliens were kind of different genres in that way.
Yeah, different genres, but he's talking about, think about more, even skewing it more towards something that doesn't feel like
internal.
Like what would happen if Sigourney Weaver in the sequel was just a mom living in the woods.
Yeah. Became a chess player.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Right. Thank you. Next up.
Hello. I'm glad that you mentioned Bond, because that's my question, actually. I'm curious, in your opinion, do you have a favorite Bond film and a least favorite Bond film, and why?
Well, my favorite is still always going to be Goldfinger, just because it's a perfect thriller. It's exotic. It's true to the book. It's that escapism, that sort of lush, very vibrant kind of high-living, desperate, benzodrine-taking spy against these sorts of larger-than-life, outrageous but rooted in reality type villains. And it's a kind of a it's this sort of fever dream of sexuality and violence. There's a great thing in Die Another Day where they have a torture sequence,
and it cuts between them dunking Bond's head in the water and torturing and beating him, and just images of sensuality and beautiful women. And I thought, that's really interesting, that credit sequence, because it's almost like it's a fever dream that his spy would have, between the beatings and the exotic flowers and the beautiful women and the cold water. It's just that life of that man on the edge that's, you know, sort of a brute, but he's also captures those very things in us which speak to romantic, you know, sort of faraway places and exotic locales. I would say worst Bond is not Skyfall, but it's close. You know, Skyfall just didn't feel like Bond to me. I like the escapist elements. Like, first off, he goes to M, he says, listen, I'm trying to kill you. We're old school, you and I. Let's not take any other agents to get protection. Just you and me, let's go off alone to a really remote location. We're away from everybody, no protection. Oh, and by the way, on the way, I'm gonna stop and pick up this really kind of cool 60s car. And we're going to take a detour out of our way just to do that, but I'm not going to get any guns and bullets. Why? Oh, well, they'll just have them when we get there. Oh, they sold them. Well, I guess we're going to make, you know, jerry-rigged weapons now.
Then it's Home Alone.
Yeah, then it's Home Alone. Also, look at the villain in Skyfall. What does he want to do? The villain wants to kill M and then kill himself. And he does. Bond loses. And that would be great if it were played that way, but it's played like Bond's accomplished a mission. But no, Bond fucked up at every level. He completely lost. The bad guy got everything the bad guy wanted. And he's weeping over this, you know, mother figure, which seems more appropriate to like a sort of Sherlock Holmes Freudian redux than it does an actual revisionist Bond film, you know. So, anyway, don't get me started. The correct answer is Moonraker.
Well, on the Moonraker, I love Moonraker, actually.
Moonraker has the Pippi Longstocking girl saying that, yeah.
George, can you help us? Well,
on the plus side, it looks like they've said everything, so maybe now they can go back to spectacle. Because I agree, some of the spectacle from your other Bond films is missing because it's so serious.
Yeah, I think they're looking to make a Bond that's a little bit more in line. And they think they may have gone way far in that direction. Thank you.
I ain't no shame.
Hey, good.
I love action movies, and the ones that I grew up with were Lethal Weapon, Long Kiss Goodnight, and The Last Boy Scout. And you have...
Wow, you're an old fan.
I am, right? And I noticed where you have the strong white character and the strong black character teaming up. My question is, did you already have that intentionally when you were writing, or was that something done afterwards? And if it was something that you had created, was there a reason why
A lot of it was market-driven. I don't really care when I write the characters. I'll write a character. I'd be thrilled if I wrote a character and maybe assumed that they would cast a white actor to cast Denzel. I'm like, through the roof, you know. So it didn't matter to me, but specifically, Long Kiss Goodnight, I was hoping that they would get someone like Sam. I think Lethal Weapon was kind of indeterminate. It was not stated in the screenplay whether they were a black and white team or not. But Warner's had just done Silverado with this breaking actor, Danny Glover, who I guess at the time was still kind of cheap to get, but they thought he was a breaking star. And I loved him. I thought Silverado, he was just great. You know, he's got such presence. And they just had this instant chemistry, which is interesting because on set, it wasn't like they were that, they didn't dislike each other, but they weren't really friends. They would shake hands, be cordial. If they're on the plane, no one's up front, read a book, Danny being back with his family. But then when you get them on screen, it's like they love each other. It's like they've been together for years. So that to me was a real remarkable thing about just the complicity of acting and how you can just fool people into thinking that you're lifelong friends, even though you're acquaintances. But no, I didn't really plan it either way. But thank you very much.
Hey, Shane, how you doing?
Good, thanks.
So the question I have is, did you start off when you wrote Shadow Company and you wrote Lethal Weapon, did you start off, did you know what genre you wanted to write in, or did you like kind of tinker around and you weren't sure what you wanted to do? Because I realize you're a really funny guy too, so.
Now I started off, I read mostly thrillers when I was in high school and college.
Okay.
And that's Stephen King horror.
Yeah. Okay.
Or it was Ludlum or Ed McBain.
Yeah, right.
Or, you know, today, thriller-wise, I don't think there's anyone better than Lee Child working out there.
Okay.
I've read his books.
Yeah.
horror thriller, and I was obsessed with war.
Yeah,
and the Vietnam War in particular. Mm-hmm. And I read all about the experience of what it was like to be over there, and had friends who came back from there and
yeah.
were very messed up. But.
Yeah.
So yeah, I wanted to do horror, but infused with the kind of grit that you see in a movie like The French Connection, or the sort
okay.
of even movies like The Taking of Pelham 1-2-3, which I found to be gritty but kind of funny at the same time, in the way that The Destroyer was.
Yeah.
And my favorite film of all time, of course, going into was The Exorcist. That still is. It's a flawless piece of film. Just, you can watch it. You can watch the new version, but I put the old version. Either one doesn't age a day.
There's good stories about that too, how it came to be.
Yeah. And there's the stories about the you know, the bad things that happen to people. Or,
yeah, I'm sad. It's in the subject.
How many people here believe in ghosts?
I've seen one.
Okay. Come on. Please, I mean, we got like, briefly, 40 second version of ghosts.
Oh, you want to hear my ghost story?
No, I'm just fucking, yes, I do.
it happens is where I grew up, there was a lot of Indian land, and I saw an Indian ghost that came around my front yard, and he was reaching out to me, and then I think he had something that he wanted to get across, and it turned out that he was murdered in the bedroom that I slept in. And so he was contacting me, and then once he finally got the story out, then he left, and I never saw him again.
Wow.
Like 19-year-old Indian kid, yeah. And I went and researched it. I went to the archives and found it. Found that the historical society of the city and found out about it. So ghosts are real. Anyone? Very real.
Well, actually, you know, it's funny because I've had friends I trust implicitly. Like, they, you know, if they say something's going on, I say, okay, I'm there, because I know they're telling me the truth.
Yeah.
They don't lie.
Yeah.
And they'll say, yeah, I just was walking through the ballroom of this old hotel, and there's a woman floating in the air.
Mm-hmm.
So what do you say? You're lying?
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. But it's weird.
All right.
Yeah, the ghost story is bullshit. Why is it always the same area? That's a very good point, because that's really the reason to remake a movie, is because it had potential that was unrealized. I think that's, I'm doing that with Remo Williams' Adventure Begins. There was a bad movie about this character and who's the hero of many, many books, and they got it wrong, so now I want to try to get it right. I think it's a great idea. Yeah, I don't know what else I...
There's a certain amount of cockiness in calling your first movie The Adventure Begins.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, no, that is true. Remo Williams, yeah, look. Print the money. I think that you're right on about that, because you have to find films, and this is, there's the RKO vault, and a lot of people without a lot of money would actually go to the RKO vault to find old films that were still available in the public domain or available cheaply, that were forgotten. Not the ones that everyone wants, you know, remake this. Here's a trivia question for you, Mr. Remake. Name me a movie, adventure movie, that was made in 1965 that starred a big actor, that was remade in 1983 with the same actor in the exact same.
We got one back here, in the back there, the black shirt.
Thunderball and Never Say Never Again.
Sean Connery as James Bond.
He told the same story twice, yeah. Hi.
Hi, so I grew up in the 80s, and I absolutely love Monster Squad.
Oh, thank you.
Yes, all right. Yes. Applause for Monster Squad, I see.
Yeah. Have you ever thought about or considered doing a spin-off
it's with Michael Bay's company, and it keeps getting tapped around, and I wish we had the rights, because, you know, that was to me our attempt to just everything we loved about Spielberg, and the film was too short, and it wasn't quite as rich as it might have been, because it just got chopped down.
But it had the classic line. I mean, a quotable line goes a long way in a movie nerds, I think.
Yeah, it did have a line. And you know the line.
Yeah, it's yours.
The Wolfman, yeah. Wolfman's got an orange, yeah.
Thank you.
Oh, no, it's coming. We'll get it to you in a minute. because I like it too.
I really appreciate your style as a screenwriter because it's just so aesthetic. And even my teachers used to say that you redefine the style of screenwriting. And as far as you explain, whenever you write, you become so terrified, like you are just like somewhere very close to being a failure. But how about directing? Is it much more fun, or do you have the same kind of feeling?
It's much more fun. It's equally terrifying, but it has to happen, and on a given day, it gets done. That's the difference. Directing, it's the train's moving, and I like that aspect of it, because once you have a start date, you have help, you go crazy, you pace around, you gnash your teeth, but you're going to shoot that scene, and it's going to get edited. It's going to be put together. The trick is to be as calm and as prepared and as in the moment as possible to take advantage of things and surprises along the way. Because too much planning means that you'll pave over some of the great moments that might just have emerged naturally. But truthfully, what for me was the biggest thrill of directing were the moments where it's the middle of the night, we're running out of time, and we realize, oh shit, we need the shot of her stealing the van. And we don't even have it scripted. And say, okay, give me a minute. And I realize I'm standing there, and I look, and you see 150 people just doing this. They're being paid to stand and watch you and wait to hear what you tell them we're doing. And I panicked at first, and then this wonderful calm sort of descended. I thought, this is great. And I thought, okay. And in the moment, once again, you can't think too much. It's just like, I could panic, but I said, this has to happen, so it will. Do this, do that. And it's wonderful to feel like, if I think too much about the entirety of the directing process, and if I think about what it's gonna mean from start to finish, I'll fall over. But if I just stick with the day, I forget that I don't know how to do it. And so many of the accomplishments I think that have worked for me and also for people I know, you just forget to not do something, or that you don't know how to do something, or in better terms, writing to me is the process of pacing, fretting, doing. Writing is finding something that even momentarily is more interesting to you than your own fear. Because you're walking in fear, and then all of a sudden something hits you, and you're still afraid, but you kind of want to write it down, and then you get sort of, and then now it's a problem to arrange the words. And in that moment, you're writing because you found something distracting for your mind. And in that instant, becomes more attractive to your brain than your own fear, which it normally just obsessively indulges. So, yeah, that's the fun of it, writing and directing for me.
Yeah, I'm going to stop writing, right?
After today, yeah.
Hey, how's it going?
It's going all right.
So when you're doing franchises, how much of it is like we're gonna save up for like a future episode, and how much of it is like we're just gonna burn everything out?
I think you have to burn everything out, you know, because you never know if it's gonna be a successful film that will generate the additional movie. And movies are different too, because in a TV show, the characters are coming back next week, so whatever happens that week on the TV show, it really can't be the most important thing that ever happened to them. Because they'll be back next week. But a good story, obviously, is about the most important thing that will ever happen to a character.
Ideally.
You have to make it, even if you're doing three movies in a row, you have to try to find ways that it feels like these are important things to the character, and ultimately made it feel like the three things were intended to belong together, almost like it was planned, even if it wasn't. So I'm sorry that you didn't feel that the plan paid off. No, really, look, you shoot me, fucking shoot me.
This just feels like there's some franchises where it's very coherent, like the Dark Knight series, and like it just everything is just bigger, but then some are just like upside. Yeah, I liked it
though, so. Okay, well, it was a good episode.
Yeah.
I appreciate that. Thank you. Good for you.
Christian, thanks for being here. My question is, I've always really liked your movies, but more than that, I like actually reading your scripts, just your writing style. And I was going to ask, when you're starting out, what were your like biggest influences for structure and developing your style?
Oh, wow. Yeah, well, to develop the style that I ended up turning to, it was... I was originally kind of wordy, right? So I read a bunch of scripts. Actually, I only read about 6, 7, 8 scripts before I felt I had enough information to concoct a style and work. And then you books picture into that too. I think you got to read everything. But ultimately, if I had to pick stylistic influences, it would be William Goldman for the sort of chatty, convivial kind of, you know, and if you think that's something, well, you see this, but yeah, but that's the good news, here's the bad news. That kind of like, up and down reversal storytelling, like you're chatting with a guy in a bar. Right? And just, that to me was very appealing. But then Walter Hill had this very Spartan, sort of almost screamingly spare prose. Like glasses tinkle, you know, bar, night, guy walks in and says to the bartender. You know. And I thought the two of them slammed together would produce probably the result I was looking for, something that had the laconic sort of off-the-cuff style of William Goldman, coupled with the energy and the drive of those bullet points that Walter Hill used. So those were the two I used to sort of, but I'm going to infuse that with whatever I feel will come across and convey things in the way I want, but the model of those two, I would go, oh, too much Goldman, go back this way, oh, too much Hill, go back this way, and that's how I kind of steered myself at first.
Cool. We're gonna need to just push through these last questions, so please no one adds the line. The last person in line, actually the last person, we'll try to get through it so that no one stood up and feels embarrassed having to sit down and ask.
Hi everyone, hi Shane, my name's Arden.
What's your name?
Arden.
Arden.
It's like Martin without the M.
You can put an M on there, it's no extra.
Okay, so I think the best thing I like hearing from you today was your little spiel about like how it's about footwork. And, you know, I play a lot of basketball, so, like, I know the importance of footwork, you know. I like that aspect that it could be, you know, transitioned to screenwriting. One of my question is, though, there's characters like, I'm going to go to Iron Man 3, and, like, the little boy, where he's kind of, like, he's a really likable character, and he's, like, there, and he's, like, a part of the story, but, like, how do you keep him where he's just enough, where we don't get too attached to him, he doesn't have to continue on in the story, you can just dispose of him, kind of like Lieutenant Dan and Forrest Gump kind of thing.
I think that once you, it's the style of the piece, once you establish that this is, for lack of a better word, expression, a Christmas Carol episode of Iron Man, he's going to meet a bunch of characters on a journey, this is like his Ghost of Christmas Past, then he meets this vengeful girl, and then he goes on to meet different people. Maya comes back into his life, the scientist. So I think it's just juggling and deciding that if you take someone who is formerly a billionaire with access to any type of technology, he can do anything, strip him down, put him in the snow, he's afraid, he's lost, and his ally is this little dork. I mean, in a way, it's the question, how do you make him as strangely pathetic as possible? So that serves the purpose, the Ghost of Christmas Past, this kid who might as easily have been Tony back in the day, comes into the story long enough to teach him a lesson and then dart out again. And I think in a movie where it's a journey movie, in this case, where he's going across the country and trying to find something, hey, stop laughing behind him, please. I know you're looking at me. Look at me, and they whisper and laugh. What the hell is that going to make me feel? Come on. And they're women. Oh, look at him, he's such an idiot.
I'm a little offended just because I'm so big they can hide behind me and laugh.
Yeah, that's right. Well, they're not laughing at you, so you get to feel good. So anyway, that's the answer.
Thanks, Harry.
Thank you so much.
Okay, Chuckles, what's up?
We were laughing about you. We met earlier, so we were talking about like what we discussed earlier.
Do you know that's where the art is?
Inside joke. Yeah.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay, so I'm Christine. I know that.
You certainly are, Christine.
So I know China is emerging to be like the biggest movie market behind Hollywood. So I know the big like Hollywood companies now, they're trying to either add like Chinese actors or add more scenes or change the ending, which I kind of know that they did that with Iron Man 3. So I was just wondering, like, what are your thoughts on the whole like Hollywood trying to, I guess, appeal?
My thoughts are that Hollywood is always going to be market driven, and China, I mean, on Iron Man, an extra $100 million was made from the China sources of revenue in China. Additionally, toys, I think, in China will add even more. So it's going to be a lucrative source. The problem was that no one quite knew what this Chinese material was to be. And it ended up, you know, being interesting. And I think it will be interesting on the DVD to watch the China footage. But I don't know. It's such a... I think America is frustrated because you can't just make a movie and sell it in China. There are restrictions, you know, and there are things the Chinese government imposes on American pictures, too. So there will be a period of reconciliation where people have to sort of get to know each other and understand the restrictions and limitations imposed by the censors and the government and all the other things. Like Django went over there and they shut off the projector at the premiere screening. So. And the guys came in and said, there's been a technical problem. Technical problem? You didn't like the movie, you know? So, anyway, I hope that China continues to the more international cooperation that the arts can achieve and the more sort of uniformity and solidarity that movies can encourage among nations, it's always got to be good. Because if people can go together, unify and appreciate a superhero movie, something as bland and simple as that, then their cultures aren't as far apart anymore. They're not as indecipherable to each other, and they have a common point of reference then. So there's a Chinese person behind you, and she's, you know, she's smiling now. So.
Thank you, Christine. Thank you.
Hello. I did have a question about Iron Man 3, and I really appreciated how you took Tony out of the suit, and I mean, loved seeing him be here without it. The one thing that I was still thinking about when I left the movie, and I probably missed it with all the flying suits, which was amazing. And
you're trying to distract people away from the obvious glaring flaws. You know, honestly, I think he confronts it when, in my thinking, when he talks to the kid, and the kid says to him, you know, I know you're afraid, but, you know, just remember who you are. You know, did you really need that thing anyway? And I think it's then a gradual building up from there. It's not as defined at the end. By the way, good question, because there was a time during the editing process where we got together, we were thinking about even reshooting it. Is that clear enough? I mean, do we need? I think the moment we didn't want to step on the moment where he says, "Jarvis, blow up the suits," because that, to me, also represents the moment where he's come to grips with his fear. What's missing is the scene, and it could very easily have been in the script, in the middle of an action scene or in the middle of a desperate moment where he starts to panic again, and you see him somehow overcome it by some inspiration or thing that outside Deus Ex Machina that he, but I think we kind of had that with the kids. I mean, don't ask the question, because you're right, so don't ask the question.
Thank you.
Hi. So my name is Stella, and my question is, so going kind of back, it's kind of weird to hear your voice, you're like talking. So anyway, my question is, going
sorry,
back.
Your shoes are blinding me, just a moment.
Sorry. Going back to what you were talking about, like despair and the highs and the lows. Do you feel like that was something that started to happen as you became a writer? Because I know for me, being an actor first of all, kind of just opened me up in a sense where I just felt like I was really sensitive. Then I started writing, and then I don't even want to leave my house, because I feel like I'm just extremely intuitive, and I'm always looking for everyone's tragic flaw, for all those things that we put into our work. And so I find it, do you feel like that's something that that you experience as well, or that you struggle with?
I think the feeling that I don't really have a life unless there's a story idea is interesting. I spend a lot of my day, I am an alcoholic. I don't know how you're drinking it.
I can.
Well, I have family members who are all around me that are alcoholics.
Yeah, so I've been sober for about 5 years and change, but what I noticed, but I'm going to go get a drink after. This experience has been so freaking mortifying. And plus, I can stop any time. I know, because I've stopped lots of times. I think a lot of it is the alcoholic mindset, which isn't necessarily the writer's mindset. It just means that I was always a loner, I was never comfortable with my own skin. You know, alcoholism, it's interesting, isn't the disease about drinking alcohol. You treat your alcoholism by drinking alcohol. That was the treatment for the disease of alcoholism, which is how you feel. And you can treat it with shopping, booze, sex, gambling, anything. All of them. So I would be very just nervous all the time. And to this day, you know, here I am, having crossed into 50, and I'll find myself, even with everything going on, just standing in my living room and not knowing what to do. Like, I don't really want to sit down. I guess I can go to the window now. And then I don't want to get the window. I just days ago, I'd go up and lie down on my bed and just, I don't really feel like sleeping right now. And there's nothing happening. It's like, it's getting through the day so I can get to the next day and it'll be the same tomorrow. Those are the times where, without a story to tell, without something to do, I feel so absolutely bleak, lifeless, and it's almost like a robot that shuts off, you know, in between, you know, robot missions or whatever. And so I guess part of what I always try to convey is just, however weird you are, great, that's good. You'll be a good writer probably, or not, but. But it's not going to be hindered by the fact that you're a fucking freak. Because, you know, and if I said how many people in this room are a fucking freak, I get some hands. These people who choose, like you say, to not leave their house, there's something wrong with that. There's something wrong with them. You should go out. You should play ball. You should have a date. Take a lover. I don't care. Just get out of the house. But no. What do? We fret. We get grandiose, we get despairing, and ultimately we come to bitch fest. As you should. Thank you.
All right.
Yeah,
that was great. So before we wrap up, a couple things. First of all,
please thank everyone for coming out.